What do you get if you take the Fourier transform of a Gaussian? Another Gaussian, as you will learn in this video. Let's take the function u of x equals e to the power minus ax squared. A is a positive real number. So we have a Gaussian and we want to compute the Fourier transform of this function. Let's check whether the integral from minus infinity to infinity of u absolute is finite. Well, u absolute is the same as u. So if we integrate this one, we know how to do this. You can use the substitution rule. X prime equals square root of a times x. You get a 1 over square root of a over here. And integral e to the power minus x prime squared dx prime, which you know from your standard calculus. For example, using polar coordinates, you can easily find that this is the square root of pi. So you get square root of pi over a, which is finite. So we can compute the Fourier transform of this function. In principle, if you are able to compute the integral, let's try. So r u hat of omega, what do we get? We integrate from minus infinity to infinity. We add this vector e to the power minus I omega x, and here we have our function u of x, and we integrate with respect to x. You see that you can form one exponent. Take out the minus a already. So you get take the minus a in front, you get the x squared from the minus a, x squared. And now a plus I omega x over a, because if you multiply by minus a, you get the minus I omega x. Then we can complete the square for this one. So the x squared plus I omega x over a, that becomes the x plus I omega over 2a, between brackets squared. And then you have to subtract the I squared omega squared over 2a, 2 squared a squared. So you have to subtract minus omega squared over 4a squared, which means that you have to add omega squared over 4a squared. So it's this part over here. And then you see that this omega squared over 4a squared does not depend on x. So you can take it in front of the integral. So that's what's done over here. Multiply by minus a and take it in front of the integral, this factor. And then you have this integral left over here. And now you see, this integral is very similar to the original one. So later in the next couple of slides, we will show that this integral with minus ax plus I omega over 2a squared is in fact the same as the integral minus infinity to infinity of minus ax squared. This will require some work, but once we have shown that, we know that the answer equals the square root of pi over a. So then we have our u hat of omega, square root of pi over a, times this factor e to the power minus omega squared over 4a. So you see that your u hat of omega is again a Gaussian, but now with the minus omega squared over 4a, instead of we started with e to the power minus ax squared. So a very broad Gaussian becomes a very small one. Now, why does this equality over here hold? So why is that true? That's actually some work, but it's a straightforward application of the theorem of residues, as we'll see in the remainder of this video. So what do we do? First, we define a function f of z equals e to the power minus az squared. We want to compute this integral in the end. So what do we take as our contour? Well, along the real axis we are happy, that will be our L1. Along L2 and L4, the parts where we are going to close, I will have to make sure that our integral is going to vanish. And then we take L3 at height I omega over 2a, such that later on it will exactly give us this integral over there. So that's the idea of our contour. So our contour consists of L1 joint L2 joint L3 joint L4. That's the first step. Second step, Cauchy-Gorsha. Well, that's easy. F of z is analytic on and inside the contour. Well, actually, f of z is analytic everywhere. So the integral equals 0. Step 3, we parameterize L1 and L3. On L1, we parameterize z equals x. So our integral along L1 of z dz becomes integrate from minus r2 to r1 e to the power minus ax squared dx. And later on, we'll send r1 and r2 to infinity, so we will get exactly this integral over there. And we know the answer. So we know the integral along L1. Now along L3, there we parameterize z equals x plus I omega over 2a. So dz is just dx, so that's fine. And we get a bit of a messy exponent over there. Boundaries from r1 to minus r2 go backwards. But this messy exponent is exactly the exponent we want to have. So that's nice. So we know what's going on here, we know what's going on over there. Total integral equals zero. Now we only want to get rid of those two over there. Along L2 and L4, we can use the ML theorem that states that if a norm of f of z is less or equal than MR on CR, then the norm of the integral along CR is less or equal than MR times LR, where LR is the length of CR. Now on L2, the one on the side, we can parameterize. We know that z equals r1 plus I omega t over 2a, where t is between 0 and 1. Just have the part from 0 to the height I omega over 2a. Then we can plug that in into f of z. So that's what we do over here. Looks a bit messy, but you can split it up into three parts. A to the power minus a r1 squared. This one with the omega and e to the power minus I r1 omega t. Now the nice part is if we take a norm, then the norm of this part over here is just 1. So, and the only place where r1 is left is over here. So what will the norm be? E to the power minus a r1 squared, okay, times norm of that one. Well, t is at most 1, so this second part is at most e to the power omega squared over 4a. So the norm of rz is bounded by e to the power minus a r1 squared times something which is basically constant. And we call that mr. And then we can apply the ML theorem. The norm of f of z is less or equal than the L of r, the length of the integration interval, which is just omega over 2a, so a fixed number, times r mr. Now what happens if r1 goes to infinity? This part and this part is just a constant factor, so we only have to deal with this part over here. And it was positive, so this vanishes very, very fast, so this limit equals zero. Now you can you have to know that the norm of the integral converges, so you can use the squeeze theorem to show that the integral for r1 to infinity along L2 equals zero, and similar arguments, similar arguments apply to L4. Now, like we can wrap everything up. We know that the integral along the total C of f of z equals zero. Now, what do we have? The integral along L1, the integral along L2, the integral along L3, and the integral along L4. Now, bring this one to the other side and invert the boundaries. And we get this integral over here. Equals this one plus this one plus this one. And then we take r1 and r2 to infinity. So what happens on the right-hand side? We've shown in step 4 that those ones cancel out, so that we are only left with this one. And this integral converges, so that's where you can apply the sum rule of the limit. The limit of the sum equals the sum of the limits, because the limits all exist. And then you have the limit on the right-hand side, the limit of this one. What do you get over there? Well, the integral from minus infinity to infinity, ugly integral. And it equals now this integral on the right-hand side, and this one. And that's what we needed, because we know this one, this was the square root of pi over a. So we knew that one on the right-hand side. So that's the last step we needed to compute our Fourier transform of a Gaussian.